Force 10 from Navarone by Alistair Maclean. Prelude. Thursday 0000 hours to 0600 hours. Commander Vincent Ryan, RN, Captain, Destroyers, and Commanding Officer of His Majesty's latest S-Class Destroyer, Sirdar, leaned his elbows comfortably on the combing of his bridge, brought up his night glasses, and gazed out thoughtfully over the calm and silvered waters of the moonlit Aegean. 4 miles away, no more, lay the brooding mass of a darkly cliff-girt island, the island of Kyros, for months the remote and beleaguered outpost of 2,000 British troops, who had expected to die that night, and who would now not die. Ryan swung his glasses through 180 degrees and nodded approvingly. The 4 destroyers to the south were in perfect line astern. He turned his binoculars to the east. A dull red glow and wisping smoke emanated from the upper part of the cliff above a great ledge of rock. 10 minutes ago, that ledge had not been there at all. There had been in its place tens of thousands of tons of rock, the most impregnable German fortress in the Aegean, and above all, the 2 great guns of Navarone, now all buried forever 300 feet under the sea. With a slow shake of his head, Commander Ryan lowered his binoculars and turned to look at the men responsible. Captain Mallory and Corporal Miller. That was all he knew of them. That and the fact that they had been sent on this mission by an old friend of his, a naval captain by the name of Jensen, who he had learned only 24 hours previously, and that to his total astonishment, was the head of Allied intelligence in the Mediterranean. Clad in saltwater and blood-stained German uniforms, filthy, unshaven, quiet and watchful, and remote, he had never before seen human beings so far gone in total exhaustion. "Well, that seems to be about it," Ryan said. "The troops on Kyros waiting to be off, and the guns of Navarone no longer in any position to do anything about our flotilla. Satisfied, Captain Mallory?" "That was the object of the exercise," Mallory agreed. He thought somberly of the comrade they had lost, of Andrea's wounds. He was confident, though, that the big indestructible Greek was recovering even now. "Then I would suggest you join your wounded Greek friend below for some sleep."
"Sleep? What a wonderful word that is." Miller pushed himself wearily off the side of the bridge and stood there swaying as he drew an exhausted forearm over bloodshot, aching eyes. "Wake me up in Alexandria."
"Alexandria?" Ryan looked at him in amusement. "We weren't there for 30 hours yet."
"That's what I meant," Miller said.
Miller didn't get his 30 hours. He had, in fact, been asleep for just over 30 minutes when he was wakened by the slow realization that something was hurting his eyes. A bright overhead light lit into the deckhead of the cabin. Miller propped himself up on a croggy elbow. Mallory was seated by a table, apparently transcribing some kind of message, while Commander Ryan stood in the open doorway.
"This is outrageous," Miller said bitterly. "I haven't closed an eye all night."
"You've been asleep for 35 minutes, Ryan said. "Sorry, but Cairo said this message for Captain Mallory was of the greatest urgency."
"It is it?" Miller said suspiciously. He brightened.
"It's probably about promotions and medals and leave and so forth."
He looked hopefully at Mallory, who just straightened after decoding the message.
"Is it?"
"Well, no. It starts off promisingly enough, mind you. Warmest congratulations and what have you." Mallory reread the message. "Signal received. Warmest congratulations. Magnificent achievement. Will evacuate you, Miller, Andrea, before dawn under diversionary air attack. Airstrip 1 mile southeast, Mandrakos.
Urgent 3. Repeat, urgent 3. Best luck, Jensen."
Miller took the message from Mallory's outstretched hand and brought his bleary eyes into focus.
"What's all this urgent 3, repeat, urgent 3 business?"
"I'd never seen it before, but I know what it means," answered Mallory wearily.
"Some people somewhere are about to die."
Thursday, 1400 to 2330 hours. The landing on Termoli Airfield on the Adriatic coast of southern Italy was bumpy. A camouflaged British Fifth Army jeep pulled up alongside the plane, and the sergeant at the wheel, having briefly established their identity, waved them inside in silence, a silence which he stonily maintained on their drive through the shambles of the war-torn streets of Termoli. The driver was obviously under the strictest instructions not to talk to them. After 20 minutes, the jeep stopped below the broad flagged steps of a house on the outskirts of the town. The house was a rather splendid example of late Renaissance architecture. The main drawing room was pleasantly redolent with the smell of burning pine from the vast and crackling fireplace at the far end of the room. A tall, heavily built and commanding figure leaned negligently against a table in the centre of the room. Mallory and his two companions looked at one another and shook their heads in slow despair. Captain Jensen smiled, strode forward to greet them, his hand outstretched.
"Mallory, Andrea, Miller, I don't know what to say. Magnificent job. How are you all?"
"Tired," Miller said firmly. "Terribly tired. We need a rest, at least I do."
Jensen said earnestly, "And that's exactly what you're going to have, my boy, a rest. A long one, a very long one. Just as soon as you get back from Yugoslavia."
"Yugoslavia?" Miller stared at him. "Tonight?"
"Tonight. By parachute."
"By parachute?"
"What do you gentlemen know about the war in Yugoslavia?"
"What war?" Andrea asked wearily.
"Precisely." There was satisfaction in Jensen's voice. "Nobody appreciates it yet, but the Yugoslavs are our most important allies in southern Europe. Their war is our war, and they're fighting a war they can never hope to win. Unless," Mallory nodded,
"the tools to finish the job."
"True. The tools to finish the job. We are the only people who are at present supplying them with rifles, machine guns, ammunition, clothing, and medical supplies. And those are not getting through." Jensen broke off, and picking up a cane, walked almost angrily across the room to a large wall map.
"Bosnia-Herzegovina, gentlemen. We've sent in 4 British military missions in the past 2 months to liaise with the Yugoslavs, the partisan Yugoslavs. The leaders of all 4 missions have disappeared without trace. 90% of our recent airlift supplies have fallen into German hands. They have broken all our radio codes and have established a network of agents in southern Italy here, with whom they are apparently able to communicate as and when they wish. Perplexing questions, gentlemen. Vital questions. I want the answers. Force 10 will get me the answers."
"Force 10? Mallory said politely.
"The code name for your operation."
Mallory moved closer to the wall map and studied it briefly.
"Bosnia-Herzegovina, well, it's a fair-sized area, sir."
"Agreed, but we can pinpoint the spot, the approximate location of the disappearances, to within 20 miles.
"Look, sir, why us?" asked Miller. "We're saboteurs, explosives experts, combat troops. This is a job for undercover espionage agents who speak Serbo-Croat or whatever."
"You must allow me to be the best judge of that," Jensen smiled. "Besides, you're lucky."
"Luck deserts tired men," Andrea said. "And we are very tired."
"Tired or not, I can't find another team in southern Europe to match you for resource, experience, and skill." Jensen smiled again. "And luck. I have to be ruthless, Andrea. I don't like it, but I have to. But I take the point about your exhaustion. That's why I've decided to send a backup team with you."
Mallory looked at the 3 young soldiers standing by the hearth, then back to Jensen, who nodded.
"They're young, fresh, and just raring to go. Marine commandos, the most highly trained combat troops we have today. Sleep's the thing now, but first I'd like a few minutes' report on Navarone, you know."
"I see." The lack of conviction in Miller's voice was total.
"All clear, then?"
"Not quite," Mallory said. "Who's in charge?"
Jensen said in genuine surprise. "Well, you are, of course." "Well, that's it, then."
Jensen affected not to notice the almost palpable rise of tension in the room and looked at the 3 sergeants.
"Confidential, I'm afraid."
As the 3 sergeants closed the double doors behind them, Jensen crossed to a side door, opened it, and said,
"Come in, General."
The man who entered was probably about 35, but looked a great deal older. Jensen said,
"Gentlemen, General Vukalovich. The general is second in command of the partisan forces in Bosnia-Herzegovina. The RAF flew him out yesterday. He's here as a partisan doctor seeking medical supplies. His true identity is known only to us. General, those are your men."
Vukalovich looked them over steadily.
Jensen continued, "With 2 exceptions, the general will be the only person in Bosnia who knows who you are and what you are doing. Whether the general reveals the identity of the others is entirely up to him. General Vukalovich will be accompanying you to Yugoslavia, but not in the same plane."
"Why not?" Mallory asked.
"Because his plane will be returning. Yours won't."
are, Mallory said. There was a brief silence while he, Andrea, and Miller absorbed the significance behind Jensen's words. Jensen went on.
Your plane, Captain Mallory, will not be returning because your plane is expendable in the interests of authenticity. Where you are going, no plane can possibly land, so you jump, and the plane crashes.
That sounds very authentic, Miller muttered.
Now, it would be fine if, by way of a bonus, you could discover why 80% of our airdrops fall into German hands. Fine if you could locate and rescue our captured mission leaders. But not important. Those supplies, those agents, are militarily expendable. What are not expendable are the 7,000 men trapped in an area called the Zeneca Cage. 7,000 starving men with almost no ammunition left. 7,000 men with no future.
We can help them? Andrea asked heavily. 6 men? You have a plan?
Not yet. Jensen rubbed his forehead wearily.
I myself arrived from Alexandria only 6 hours ago. By tonight, who knows?
A few hours' sleep this afternoon might transform us all. But first the report on Navarone. It would be pointless for you three other gentlemen to wait. There are sleeping quarters down the hall. I dare say Captain Mallory can tell me all I want to know.
Jensen waited till the door closed behind Andrea, Miller, and Vukalovich, picked up his cane, crossed to the wall, pulled down 2 more maps.
Now then.
You have a plan, Mallory said carefully.
Of course I have a plan,
Jensen said coldly. He wrapped the map in front of him.
10 miles north of here, the Gustav Line. Right across Italy, along the line of the Sangro and Liri rivers. Here the Germans have the most impregnable defensive positions in the history of modern warfare. And here, the Anzio beachhead. 50,000 Americans fighting for their lives. For 5 solid months now, we've been battering our heads against the Gustav Line and the Anzio perimeter. Our losses in men and machines, incalculable. Our gains, not one solitary inch. Our only hope of breaching the Gustav Line is by weakening the German defensive forces, and the only way we can do that is by persuading them to withdraw some of their front-line divisions. Jensen wrapped the map again. Every airfield between here and Bari is jammed with dummy bombers and gliders. Outside Foggia, it's the biggest military encampment in Italy, but occupied by only 200 men. The harbours of Bari and Taranto are crowded with assault landing craft, the whole lot made of plywood. All day long, columns of trucks and tanks converge on the Adriatic coast. Now, if you, Mallory, were in the German High Command, what would you make of this?
I suspect an airborne and sea invasion of Yugoslavia, but I wouldn't be sure.
The German reaction exactly, Jensen said with some satisfaction. They're badly worried. Worried to the extent that they have already transferred 2 divisions from Italy to Yugoslavia to meet the threat.
But they're not certain.
Not quite, but almost.
Jensen cleared his throat.
You see, our 4 captured mission leaders were all carrying unmistakable evidence pointing to an invasion of central Yugoslavia in early May.
They carried evidence?
Mallory broke off, then went on quietly.
And how did the Germans manage to capture them all?
We told them they were coming, and it will be your job, my boy, to turn near conviction into absolute certainty.
Seemingly oblivious of the fact that Mallory was regarding him with a marked lack of enthusiasm, he wheeled round dramatically and stabbed his cane at a large-scale map of central Yugoslavia.
The valley of the Neretva, Jensen said. The vital sector of the main north-south route through Yugoslavia, and no one knows this better than the Germans. They are fully aware that an invasion of Yugoslavia is on the cards. They're terrified of a link-up between the Allies and the Russians advancing from the east, and they know that any such link-up must be along this valley. They already have 2 armored divisions along the Neretva, 2 divisions that in the event of invasion could be wiped out in a night. From the north, here, they are trying to force their way south to the Neretva with a whole army corps. But the only way is through the Zeneca Cage here. And Vukalovich and his 7,000 men block the way.
Vukalovich knows about this, Mallory asked. About what you really have in mind, I mean.
Yes, and the partisan command. They know the risks, the odds against them. They accept them.
Photographs? Mallory asked.
Here. Jensen pulled some photographs from a desk drawer.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.